Bransfield.
Chalk it up as an admirable failure. The club landed in February of 2008 and was forgotten by, I'd say, around July 2008. Maybe I'm being unfair there, but it does feel like this one was such a brief thing in the history of gaming. And that in itself isn't really fair. The club was a weird one, sure, but it deserved a lot better than it ended up getting. The premise was simple, but still surprising. What if Bizarre Creations oversaw the unholy union between Project Gotham Racing and Geometry Wars, resulting in an obscene mutant hell beast child? An on-foot shooter where you drove humans around a track littered with lead and steel, striking everything that moves with hot death nuggets, and it all featured neither cars nor neon shapes. That what if was this what was, the club. At its very basic level, a third-person shooter, the game would have been utterly mediocre if that were the full story. You run, you sprint, you iron sight as though it's a verb, you shoot a lot, you lob the odd grenade, you pick up much more ammo. You switch from pistol to shotty to automatic, the body count is ludicrously high. It works fine, it controls well, it's a 6 out of 10. Thing is, the Project Gotham and Geometry Wars comparison wasn't one that came about solely because the club was made by Bizarre. It wasn't just looking at the studio's recent history and extrapolating from there. The game was made to be an amalgam, of sorts, of the score attack arcade shooter and the kudos-heavy demi-sim racer. Ben Ward, Bizarre's community and web lead at the time, told GameSpy, "It's incredibly important for a game to be built to encourage replayability and to have a strong community built around it. Geometry Wars has taught us bundles about both of these things, and we're going to apply this to the club in spades." Describing the game, "I think a racing game with guns pretty much nails it. Speed is absolutely essential, but you'll need to learn the courses and master the corners, aka dispatching the enemies, before you top the leaderboards." When you realised this, when it sank in that the game wasn't just about shooting all the baddies and getting to the exit, that there was more to it than that and you should expect to replay levels multiple times, that you should be looking to keep a hold on the combo meter you always had such a tentative grasp on, that you really needed to focus to try and knock your score up by a few thousand, or million, when all that soaked in, the club became a really nifty little thing. I'm sure there are other games like it, I just can't think of any, so as far as my brain's concerned, it was a unique experience. As Gareth Wilson, lead designer on Blur, told VG247 a few years after the club released, "We were really pleased with it from a design perspective because fundamentally we were trying to make a race and retry kudos-based shooter where you had high scores and you had to repeatedly try to better your score as you ran around each level, with each level being kind of like a track. So basically like Gotham does shooting, which was the high-level goal of it." I'd love to say it was received well at the time, and it disappearing from the gaming consciousness was all a grand misunderstanding by the game's playing public, or a travesty on the scale of the original release of Shadow of the Colossus, selling about 20 copies even though it's one of the best things ever made. But that's not the tale that gets told about the club. It did review well, and there was plenty of praise doing the rounds, but it ended up with a Metacritic rating ranging from 67 to 76 across its three formats, Xbox 360, PS3, and PC. It wasn't hated, sure, but it certainly wasn't wholly embraced by the critics. And that's because, well, they were right. The club wasn't great. It was original, well-made, and compulsive when you got into that zone and just needed to beat yours or a friend's score on a track level, whatever you want to call them. But it was often middling. Only a few weapons were worth using, differences between characters were minimal at best despite their stats being front and center, the lack of story was such that it stopped being a boon for the game and instead made it feel lacking in point or atmosphere, and dare I say it, after a few hours play you'd likely be bored, and after you'd got bored you likely wouldn't go back to it again for quite a while. Sure, when you did go back to it, the score attack nature of things would give a nice pang of enjoyment for a while, but the club was very much something that lost its allure after not too long in its presence. But that all led the world to one big collective thought. The sequel could fix all of this. The club was a great foundation on which to build, and the club too could take all the good bits, fix all the bad bits, and give us the truly great game we all knew Bizarre could. But then this happened. Though, being more accurate here, Activision actually bought Bizarre about 4 or 5 months before the club, published by Sega, released. The club hadn't even come out, and already there was little chance of a sequel ever happening. The game ended up being Bizarre's last non-Activision published title to get a physical release, and the club arriving in such tumultuous circumstances led to a few elements working against any possible sequel. The talent experienced in making the first game had gone elsewhere, but they still couldn't work on the club too, as Sega held the license. For Sega's part, it could have made the sequel, but with the original being that unique offering, why would the publisher bother when, yes, the talent which actually knew what it was doing and what was needed to fix things had gone elsewhere? Additionally, the fact that Bizarre was sodding off to the bigger rival publisher must have ruffled a fair few wigs at Sega, and don't get me wrong, this is based on assumption and no evidence, but the club didn't see a huge amount of marketing around its launch, and only ended up shifting about 270,000 copies in its lifetime. I can't say it was sent out to die with certainty, but I can assume that and say it anyway. Speaking to Edge magazine, Bizarre's managing director Martin Chudley said, "We enjoyed working on the club and I think Sega might have made more of it if we'd continued with them on to a sequel. They wanted us to get a lot closer, but it obviously wasn't going to work because we were going to Activision. Obviously, they didn't have anybody to do a sequel, so therefore they weren't going to put all their efforts into marketing the first one. At that point, we'd already stated we weren't going to go on with it." So let's go back and revise my comment a minute ago about assuming the club was sent out to die. It was sent out to die. In a somewhat ironic twist, it was actually in some small way because of the club that Bizarre was sold to Activision to begin with. So the decision to sell was because the company wanted to make a game which it then couldn't do a sequel to because the studio had been sold. Got it? Good. As Sarah Chudley, commercial director at Bizarre, told VG247, "We just got to the point where we were looking forward. The club took us about a year to sign up. A year is a long time when you've got 50 staff sitting there twiddling their thumbs in early development stages because obviously the publisher has quite an influence into what type of game is made. We've got a lot of money in the bank, but that used to be 5 years worth of money and then 3 years worth of money, and then you think, well, there are a lot of people resting on this." It's not the saddest story out there about a game, and the fact that the club is largely forgotten these days really isn't much of a surprise. The simple fact is that first and only game wasn't quite up to par. It was a great idea that needed work to be something really special, and circumstances conspired to ensure it would never get that work done on it. But it is still a game worth remembering and highlighting. The club was ahead of its time. Had it come out 10 years later, there is every chance it'd have ended up a well-remembered, much-played, regularly updated staple of the online competitive scene. It wasn't deep or particularly clever, but it didn't need to be because it was fun. That said, if it had come out 10 years later, the club wouldn't have been able to be made by Bizarre Creations, which was shut down by Activision just 3 years after the publisher gobbled the developer up. Oh well, eh? Giga thanks to those of you who patronise me on Patreon, especially for sticking with me recently while I've been a bit all over the place in the real world. If you want to join this fine list of Fiverr and above folks, or even the unmentioned masses who donate smaller numbers, the link is below. And And, of course, mega giga thanks to the higher tier supporters, some of whom I did drawings of, because apparently that was an idea I had. Bought a drawing tablet and everything. Anyway, Paintball Magazine PBM. Lola Osman. Dakar Horshi. I'm gonna go shave another second off my runs using the power of gun violence. Bye!